We go to the last talk. Benoît Ladoux from Institut Jacques Monod. Mechanical plasticity of epithelial cells during collective migration.
So thanks first to Jean-François and Thomas for the nice meeting and for the invitation. So I can hear what you have in mind, that some kind of oof is the last. So which is the good news. The bad news is that, you know, this place is full of history and tradition, and as I learned from Thomas and Jean-François, the last speaker has unlimited time. So be ready to stay for a while, and it's better to start quickly. So today I will talk about polarity and plasticity, mostly in collective cell migration, under mechanical constraint, physical constraint. To start with, I will take these two examples to reply to the reviewer one, who was always asking what is the relation about the work you're doing and in vivo system. Here you have two examples of collective cell migration. One is in the Drosophila, where you have this in the zebra fish, where you have the movement along the lateral line of the fish. And this is an example from Darren Gilmore. And as you can see here, you have an open space, and you have cells at the tip which are migrating, and you have different organization inside, and this kind of leader cells and follower cells that are leading to this movement. So basically, what I want to emphasize here is the fact that you may have collective cell migration in system where, which is the case in wound healing, for instance, where you have an open space. You have other situations, and I really like this one, where you have complete confinement. So this one is in Drosophila, in the egg chamber. And so I will take the egg chamber in a different perspective this time. We heard yesterday about the border cell migration. Here, mostly take the representation of these follicle cells that you can see in green, which are rotating along the egg chamber. Okay, so you have a full coordination of these follicle cells along the egg chamber, as a function of time. And this is a very good example for me, because you have rotation, but on top of the rotation, you have also, at some point, I mean, I will not enter into all the details of that. So the cells are moving from the basal part of the cell are at the outside here, and the apical part is inside. And as the cells are moving along this egg chamber, you have a reorganization of the extracellular matrix, so you have an alignment of this collagen fiber. Together with the alignment of the collagen fiber, as you can see here, you have stress fiber which are building up. Okay, so you have some kind of transition also in the system, where you have a large polarization of the actin stress fiber. And on top of it, you have not only actin polarization at the scale of the stress fiber, but you have also front-back polarity, meaning that each cell is polarized in the system, and you have this kind of like full rotation in this closed environment. So basically, you can have change of the extracellular matrix that leads to the formation of this actin stress fiber, which are aligned along the direction of the matrix. So change of the physical properties of the matrix. But the polarization of the stress fiber could be linked also to some kind of like a polarity at the single cell, front-back polarity, by the formation, for instance, of lamellipodia. All right, so the question I would like to ask is, how can we trigger the emergence of polarity at the single cell level? Can we look at that in terms of by changing, for instance, the environment? And I will just give a brief example of that. And then I will talk about multicellular coordination. And basically, what can we learn about a tissue which is confined in a system and that will undergo some dynamics? All right. So the first example is something that we developed a very long time ago with Olivia Durour, Pascal Silberzon, and Axel Buguin. And we use this kind of substrate to measure forces. I mean, you heard about from Chavi about the traction force microscopy. It's another kind of traction force microscopy where you have cells plating on those micropillars. And then you can measure the deflection of the pillar by measuring the forces, the deflection of the pillar. The interesting point here is that you can measure the force, but you can also change the rigidity by changing the length of those structures. Okay? So that's what we did. Basically, we looked at the effect of stiffness by changing the length of the pillar on the organization of cell. And we mostly focus on so that's the typical experiment we have. You have the pillar here that you can see. You can measure, as a function of time, you can measure the deflection of the pillar. Each arrow represents the direction of the force, and the amplitude of the arrow represents the the magnitude of the force. And then you can look at the actin cytoskeleton at the same time. You can also look at focal adhesions and so on and so forth. And we were interested in looking mostly with the that was a work that started in Paris with Raphael like more than 10 years ago, and continue at the MBI with at the Mechanobiology Institute in Singapore with a PhD student and a postdoc. And what we decided to look at is mostly the organization of the actin cytoskeleton as a function of the stiffness. And as you can see again, as I was mentioning before, that you have this emergence of polarity or polarization, basically, of the actin stress fiber. It's some kind of transition that you also observe when you change the stiffness of the substrate. So when you move from a soft surface here, okay, and you increase the stiffness little by little, and you have here the emergence of domains, again, of actin, which can align. This state is slightly different from the others. I will not enter into the details of that, but on very soft surface, you have this basically quite a strong lamellipodia all over the cells, and you have actin flows which are directed toward the center of the cell here. And as you move towards stiffer substrate, what you observe is that you started to form domains and stress fiber which are aligned locally. And as you move towards stiffer and stiffer substrate, you have a preferential direction of this stress fiber that can dictate, for instance, the polarity of the cells, if you can imagine, or its migration. So we end up thinking of that as a system that can first have this kind of transition, isotropic nematic transition, as you move from softer to stiffer substrate, and also something which is more like on a liquid phase. If you want, you have more flows on soft, and more stable structure that are formed based of the stress fiber formation on stiff surfaces. All right, and so basically changing the environment, as I was showing in this Drosophila X-chamber example, can change the polarity, and you can change the polarization, should be careful of the word, the polarization of the actin cytoskeleton. So the actin cytoskeleton, if you want, can be some kind of large-scale sensor of the rigidity or some kind of physical parameter of the environment. What we did a bit more, and we struggle a lot to obtain those kind of substrate, as you can imagine, is to try to see if we can reproduce some durotactic experiment that was mentioned yesterday by Chavi using those micropillar substrates. So you can make substrate with different stiffness, again, by changing the height of the pillar. Okay, so you have soft substrate here and stiffer substrate here, and that's really something that we developed with an amazing person at the in charge of the microfabrication group at the MBI, Gianluca Grenzi. And by doing so, what you observe is that when the cell is moving from soft to stiff, indeed, you can obtain, under some condition, you can obtain this durotactic behavior of the cell. So this is a fibroblast, a Re52. You have the actin staining here. And what you can observe is the fact that when the cell here is spread, just to this example to show you that the cell is spread half at first on the soft substrate and half on the stiff one, that I will show you later. And what you observe is that you have an organization even which is different on one side of the cell and on the other. And you can, of course, measure the force also as the cell is durotaxing from the soft to the stiff substrate. And here, if you look at that, so you have this kind of chessboard pattern with stiff, soft, soft, stiff substrate. And as you look at cells at the interface between these two substrates, what you observe is that you have indeed the emergence of alignment of stress fiber on one side, on the stiff part of the substrate, that can trigger the polarity and potentially the migration of cells towards the stiffer part of the substrate. And at the back, you have the organization of the exactly the similar organization of the one I was showing you on the soft surfaces, okay, with this kind of like more transverse fiber, basically, and radial fiber, which are emerging from the edge of the cell. And based on this picture, it just tells you that finally you can get this durotactic and that this rigidity sensing can be indeed can occur at the subcellular scale and not really at the full cellular scale in a sense, because here even when the cell is touching the stiff substrate, you see the emergence of this polarization of this actin stress fiber. So that was the point I wanted to emphasize here. All right. So now I have a copyright from Raphael for this slide. So what I show you is basically this kind of transition. That step one, you have one cell that can transit to some kind of like more disorder state to a more order state. You can actually look at that in a more complex system, meaning cell doublets. But I will focus more today about could happen in, if you have a multicellular system, so at a larger scale than this cell doublet, so you have multiple cells that can interact with each other. All right, so of course it's a complex system. You may have like a lot of dynamics that are emerging, dynamics at the cell age, which is, for instance, I will come back to that, but the formation of leader cells, the follower cells. You can have traveling waves, so you can have a complex behavior at the back of the cells. You can have swirls, reminiscent of what people call active turbulence, for instance, topological defect, as it was mentioned by Carles before, and other things. So here, and if you look at the this complexity, I would like to mention two examples before I start. One of them is from the group of Pascal Silberzan, and what they show basically is that when you have cells which are migrating on a substrate, so this is the same micropillar substrate I was showing before, but in that case you can use those substrates to probe the forces exerted by multicellular systems. What you obtain is a force, so you have the force as a function of the distance from the typical finger that you form here, which is, so here you have a leader cell. So you have a finger which is protruding from this monolayer, okay? And what you can do is you can integrate the force along this direction and you can measure the force as a function of the distance. Basically, what you obtain from this force pattern, to be brief, is the fact that you have force that almost compensate at the scale of this multicellular finger. Okay, so you have a multicellular coordinated entity, if you want, at a local scale. I mean, a local scale, which is still something that encompasses a few cells, indeed, in the formation of those fingers. Okay, so basically, the force is almost balanced at the scale of this leader cell. And you have other typical movement inside monolayers, which have been described first by this paper in Journal of Cell Science in 2005, showing that indeed, when you look at cellular monolayers, you have, so this is MDCK cells in that case, you have cells which are extended what they call cryptic lamellipodia, meaning that even in the bulk of the tissue, you may have cells that extend protrusion underneath the other cells. Okay, so that's something that you can clearly see here if you look at the basal part of the cell. So you may potentially think that there might be some at least autonomous behavior of cells inside the bulk of the tissue. There are other experiments, basically the one from Chavi, for instance, showing that, sorry, I was going too fast, showing that if you look at monolayers now, and if you integrate the forces as the cells are moving toward a given direction. So here you have MDCK cells, again, on a substrate, which is flexible, so you can measure the force. If you measure the force in this system, you can also compute the stress, okay, inside the system. And the fact that you have so what you are measuring here is the stress as a function of the distance from the edge of the monolayer. So you measure the stress, which is zero here at the edge, and what you can observe is that as you are moving from the edge to the center of the monolayer, the stress is increasing. So you have a building up of stress as you move from the edge to the center, meaning that you have a tensile stress which is building up and that the tissue is under tension, but that this tension should be provided by a long-range coordination. Okay, so you have this long-range coordination, and indeed you have several papers, the first one pioneered by the group of Chavi, again showing that you have also waves of propagation of different mechanical cues inside monolayers when they are migrating, and even this explanation of the durotactic behavior of collective migration is based on this idea that you may have a long-range coordination. So what I wanted to say is that here you may have like the title of the talk was mechanical plasticity, and the idea of mechanical plasticity is that basically you may have different behavior that can be explained differently, and that the system can switch potentially to a different mechanical state. And to explore a little bit that, what we develop is a simple system, which is this. We have a ring of fibronectin on the substrate, and we have a PEG brush in the center and on the outside. So meaning that the cells will only adhere on this ring here. Okay, and when you play the movie, what you observe is that spontaneously the system will start to rotate as it reaches the confluency on this ring. Okay, because I will have the question. So it's you have 50-50, it's clockwise, anti-clockwise. There is no chirality in the system. But then what you can do is that you can play with the geometry. If you play with the geometry, you can make like different systems, you can change the width of the ring, you can change the diameter, you can go until 1 millimeter in diameter, which is like huge. And you can, of course, you can make triangles, you can change a little bit the shape. What you observe is that in all those cases, this is MDCK cells, but it's working with almost all the epithelial cells that we used in the system. They start rotating, okay, as soon as they reach the confluence. So there are two questions that we wanted to ask using this system is what leads to the what breaks the symmetry, what makes the system turning in one direction or the other, and the second question is how this kind of rotation is maintained over time. So to do that, so again, you have the movie, you see that they are fluctuating a little bit, then they start to form a contact, and as soon as they form the last contact, those cells are starting to rotate, okay? And they can rotate for a very long time. So we can quantify a little bit this parameter, which is a little bit what we call the coordination parameter, which tells you basically if the cells are rotating clockwise, or if there is no rotation, or if they are rotating anti-clockwise. All right. Okay, so the first question is, so I have no answer to the two questions I asked, but at least we have some hints about that. The first question is how the symmetry is broken. So we looked at different parameters. It turned out that one of them is, we looked at the velocity, and of course, when you establish the last contact, you have two trains which are facing each other, okay? And one of them contains more cells which are migrating in the same direction. So that's what you have here on this PIV field. You have cells which are moving in this direction here in blue, okay, which are more numerous than the cells which are moving in the opposite direction in red. And as the system is touching, as the system is indeed establishing the last contact, then those cells are starting to rotate, and the winning part is, as you would expect, so I would not ask you to bet on that, is the fact that the cells which the longest train is winning over the shortest one. In almost all the cases. So this is one of the parameters. What we looked at is also the polarity, how the polarity is changing as the cells are making this contact. And for that, we use a P21 activated kinase that show you the active form of RAC or CDC42. And here, what you observe is that very quickly, after the formation of the last contact, the cell which will repolarize exhibit a strong, stronger activity of this active RAC on the side which is moving collectively toward in that case, it's a counterclockwise rotation. So here it forms a contact. This cell is winning over the other one, and the other one is repolarizing in the opposite direction. So why is it so? We tried various parameters. One of them that looks interesting is we heard about like weighting before, is the fact that when we looked at the angles made by the two cells, we observed that most of the time, so those cells is sending a large lamellipodia. This lamellipodia will protrude underneath the other cells, and what we observe is that usually when you measure that quantitatively, when you measure the angles that the two cells are making just before establishing the last contact, what we obtain is a rotation which will go in the direction of the cells which have the strongest lamellipodia, so which wets the most the substrate in a sense. So this is one parameter. The other one, which is interesting, and it's the same idea, is that once the cell is establishing this contact, sending a cryptic lamellipodia underneath the other cells, and this cell which is winning, wanted to understand there would be a way to understand why this lamellipodia can be maintained in a sense. And so we heard a lot about this experiment, so I will not come back to this idea. So at the single cell level, we've got confinement of cells that can lead to movement and polarity. And so we saw that maybe at the subcellular scale, a similar event can happen. And so what we did is to use a PDMS block. Okay, so you have a PDMS block. PDMS is polydimethyl siloxane, anyway. It's a silicone that you place in front of the cell, and you just let a tiny space in between here to let the cells extend the lamellipodia. Okay? And as you do that, what you observe is that before confinement, of course, they extend lamellipodia, but just after confinement, you have a very strong lamellipodia that emerge through the fact that the cells are through this confinement. So it's not only that you have a strong lamellipodia, the protrusion velocity is also increasing as you confine cells. So what we think is that potentially, similarly to this idea of triggering polarity by confinement at the cellular level, potentially the fact that you may send cryptic lamellipodia underneath the other cells and that that one cell will send this lamellipodia underneath the other one can help to maintain the polarity in one direction. So we looked at that, so the maintenance of this collective coordination, and indeed, when you look at the coordinated behavior of those cells, again, we use this active RAC probe. We observe that we have that almost all of the cells exhibit a gradient of RAC as they move. In that case, in the clockwise direction. Okay, so you have more RAC at the front here than at the back. So you see that the shape is a bit wavy here, but you have more RAC at the front than at the back, and that's so you can quantify that, and you have a gradient per cells, you have a gradient of RAC in the system. So it seems that once the system is starting to rotate, you have some kind of establishment of the polarity at the single cell level, so each cell seems to be polarized, okay? So the next experiment that we thought of doing to try to understand if there is indeed this idea of single cell polarity and that single cell can trigger collective movement is to measure the traction forces. So what we did is, so now we did that in this traction force microscopy. So we use these beads movement and we looked at how the beads are moving as a function of time, not this micropillar system because it was a bit complicated here. And we looked at that as the cells are rotating. So when we did that, surprisingly, what we obtained is this kind of chymograph. So this is a chymograph of the orthoradial forces, okay, which is theta along the ring, and as a function of time. And what you observe here is that you have alternative stripes of blue and red that emerge in this that you can see clearly in this chymograph. So if you look carefully at the value, the red values are positive forces and the blue values are negative forces. Okay, and if you try to match the scale here that you have between a red line and a blue line, what you observe is that it almost matches the size of a single cell. So basically, even on this, using this traction force measurement, what we obtain is that at the single cell level, we've got force dipole. That emerge at the single cell. So there is no like large force indeed which is propagating from one cell to another. But what we have mainly, is a force dipole at the single cell level. So again, what we obtain here is the for this rotation, we need the system to establish the rotation. Once the rotation is established, it seems that each cell is polarized. Each cell has its own force dipole and almost contribute individually to the movement. All right. So there, it's not the end of the story. Then you wanted to know a little bit what is the role of the cell-cell junction. Do you need only physical contact, for instance, to trigger this kind of collective rotation? So when you do that, there are different ways of like manipulating the cell-cell contact. Here, what I can show is two examples where we have this the cadherin, the alpha catenin knockdown, for instance, and the MDCK cells or the some snail overexpression. In both cases, you basically alter the cell-cell the cell-cell junction, mainly the adherent junction, and what you observe is that you don't really have rotation. Okay. So you clearly need the formation of those cell-cell contact to have the initiation of the rotation. So it's not only physical contact that would lead to this coordination. All right, and I think probably the even more interesting experiment is the one that we did for using calcium switch. Okay, so what we decided to do was to look at that dynamically. It turned out that the only way we managed to have this kind of dynamic probe of the cell-cell junction, the influence of cell-cell junction on this coordinative rotation was to use calcium media. So we use low calcium. When you have low calcium, what you observe is that so the cell-cell junction are not properly formed, there is no rotation. And at confluency, you switch to normal calcium, and then, boom, the cells are starting to rotate, okay? And after, you move back to the low calcium media, and they keep rotating. They keep rotating, so this is a quantification here, they keep rotating for hours, okay? Meaning that they, there is, again, this idea of, of polarity, potentially, of polarity of memory of polarity, sorry, that could lead to the emergence of the the maintenance, sorry, of this coordinated movement. And okay, well, maybe I will skip this slide if I can. And then we did some very simple agent-based model with the Victoire Cachou, and she was an intern in the group of Alexandre Cabla in Cambridge, to recapitulate basically the type of observation that we've got experimentally, which is based on the fact that you have force contact, you have a motile force for each cell, which is could be zero if the cell is static, it could be plus or minus F if the cells are moving in one or the opposite direction, and on top of that, each cell is indeed in contact with two others, so you have forces exerted by the neighbor on these cells, and you have some noise in the system, plus some friction, of course. So based on that, we can recapitulate at least some of the experimental observation, at least this kind of like formation of the large polarity and the rotation of the system in the ring. All right, and the end of the story is that I was talking about the Drosophila chamber, and it turns out that what we did with Si Wong, who is now a CNRS researcher in the lab, was to use my tubes where we grow cells and to mimic a little bit more this drosophila-like chamber I was mentioning before. And we looked at the migration of cells at first in these tubes. So we can indeed change the dimension of the tubes and we can look at the migration first. It turned out that when those cells, if you plate cells on both sides of the tubes, at some point they will reach confluency. And what you observe in this system when they reach confluency is the fact that they start to rotate again. So you have a complete rotation of the system, and that's a work that I can present maybe next time, and that we are doing with Carles and Jacques Pro to understand this rotation on tubes and I mean inside tubes and on fibers. All right, so I will stop here to say that indeed, we observe that there is some polarity indeed in the system that can emerge at the single cell level that can be triggered by the physical constraint. I was telling you a little bit about the example of rigidity, but it could be also triggered by the some kind of memory effect indeed in the system where you have those cells that extend lamellipodia, and then indeed once the system reaches a given speed and coordinated rotation, it can maintain this polarity even though you are losing, like, not physical contact, but biochemical contact with at least through the cell-cell junction with the neighbors. All right, and with that, I will thank the people who did the work I mentioned today. So, of course, my collaborator, René Marc-Mège at the Institut Jacques Monod, Simon Debeco, who did some optogenetics on the rotation system that I did not mention, Joseph and Victor, who really participate extensively to this work, of course, Shriyan Jain, who is now a postdoc at the Institut Pasteur, Alexandre Glentis and Si Wong for the last part, and the very first part on rigidity was done in collaboration with Mike Sheets, Brian Dos and Pan Meng at the MBI, and of course the collaborator for the work, the theoretician Victoire and Alex, Raphael, Philippe Marc, that I did not mention, but this idea of rotation basically came with a discussion with Philippe at the very beginning when we were thinking that there might be waves in the system. It turns out that we never found any waves in the rotation system. And Carles and Jacques that I mentioned. And you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Merci.